Hi, everybody. My name is Stephanie Benson, and I'm doing a one-on-one with gunmusic.com. I am a typical Ashanti woman. Actually, that's a lie. Not really. But I grew up here and left when I was 15. I think it's 14, actually. I was born in Accra. My father was a pharmacist and my mother was a queen mother. And from the age of three, I always loved music. So I played the piano with my father 3 years old. I mean, I wasn't really good, but he would play and I would sit on his lap. And that's where, you know, music, I think, became a part of my life. And by the age of 10, I had a scholarship to the National Academy of Music. I left at 14 and went to England. I had to live with my uncle, who really was very strict. The music was in my blood, and I think he realized that. So because he realized I was sort of a loner, he bought me a piano and did a room up in the loft for me. So I stayed there, and all I did was play piano and you know, sing. One day it was after school, university, and I decided that I would stop by Stringfellows. A lot of you would not know what Stringfellows is, but it was one of the top nightclubs that all the stars were into. I mean, name it, everybody was there. You know, Mel Gibson to, you know, Sean Connery, and, you know, when they came to London, this is the club they went to. And one of my friends was working there as a waitress, you know, gorgeous white girl. Tutu skirts and whatnot, and she asked me to come, and I looked at her and I said, well, I can't dress like that, my family will kill me. But there was a piano in the corner. I went to the piano, and actually I didn't go to the piano initially, somebody was playing, so I went to Peter Stringfellows. It was huge. I think he had Mel Gibson and a couple of other stars sitting on the same table. I went to him at, I think, 17, 18 years old, and I said, I'm sorry to bother you. I think I can play the piano better than the young lady who's playing, so can you give me a chance? So that's how my music career started. I got the piano, played, and he hired me. And then from that, I got signed to record label Stockade and Waterman. Some people would know what Stockade and Waterman is. It signed Kylie Minogue and so many other, Rick Astley, all the, you know, the pop icons of the 80s. And I was signed to that label as the princess. And that's how my career started. That is an interesting story, because when I was with Stockade and Waterman, if anybody knows Pete Waterman, he is really very controlling in a good way. I mean, he makes stars, but it was strictly pop. And I am, although I wanted to get into music, I really didn't want to do pop strictly. It was very successful for me. I mean, it really worked for me. But after my first two hit singles, I asked him if I could change my genre and do a little bit more R&B and soul R&B. And he said, okay, we'll think about it later. And it was never happening. So when the album was about to come out, I just spoke to him. I said, it has to change, because I mean, my heart is not in pop. You know, because it's one line, is not, you know, and the writing was really just pretty basic. And I studied literature, so I had just the words and lyrics are so important to me, and I read a lot. So I had to walk. And he told me that if I walked, I couldn't take my name. And, you know, so I said, cool. So I walked, I didn't take my name. My life at home is really very simple. As much as I love people in the UK, I live in, you know, on a 40-acre land with horses and dogs and children. I'm a people person, but when I go home, I just want that peace. So I have no neighbors, which is really nice. I mean, we have like a pathway where people can take on the country road to walk their dogs, but that's on through the side of the house, you know. And that's as much as, you know. So I love people. So because all my work is with people, when I come home, I want it to be just myself with my children and my husband and my dog. Yeah, which is, you know, the I'm normal, it's as normal as they come. I hide in wardrobes and I pop out when they go to bed, and I'll be hiding in the road for at least an hour, and then I wait till they go to sleep and I scare the hell out of them. I do like crazy crap like that. I'm like, you know, I'm the extremist. They'll wake up and there'll be squid on the top of the door, and they, you know, and they think some alien has invaded their room. No, it's very normal in my household. Walk around the house naked, nobody cares. I flick my son's legs.
What?
I flick my son's legs and whatnot. I flick my son's legs.
Jesus is Lord!
Obviously, I met Stevie Wonder through Akusia Buzia, and we struck up a really nice friendship. That was good because I'm very cheeky and verbal, and so is he. So we sort of like, yeah, and he liked that. I met Smokey Robinson. We although we didn't have a friendship, but he's a cute guy. You know, he said hi, and sat down and talked a little bit. I met one that I struck a friendship with was Mike Tyson. I mean, he's cool. So yeah, I really think Tyson, yeah, he's so cool. We used to sit outside Ventura Boulevard and drink champagne and look at the nice cars going by. And he always wanted to buy me shoes. I've got the nastiest feet possible, but he still wanted to buy me shoes. Hard work. I mean, my performance has always been very flirty. I've always, from the age of 20 something, when I perform, I'm all about the audience. So I mean, I'll be playful, I'll walk around, I sang for Prince Charles and I sat on his lap pretty much for some, and you know, he likes that. I've sang for him many times actually after that, because he likes me sitting on his lap. So I mean, why not? I've sang for Prince William, had a private party, one of his friends during his 5th birthday, I sang for him. And Prince Harry and I had a really nice call, because every time I sang for Prince Charles, he happened to be there, and he usually wouldn't let anybody speak to me. He'd be like, "My, maybe I'm the one who should have married. God, I should have killed my husband earlier." So I've had a lot of fun with these people because they've heard from me usually because of my performances. So it's not just really about voice, because they hear so many amazing artists. But when you get a chance like I have to sit and, you know, even have a drink with them. And I remember I was booked to just do 20 minutes the very first time I sang for him. And I took my son with me because it was only 3 weeks. And he was cradling him as I was singing. It's like 1,200 people in the garden. And a lot of them came with their waiters and the butlers, and they set up tables and there were, you know, all the drinks, and so the tables of families and this big field. It was just beautiful. Like, walked in, I'm thinking, oh my God, this is like so grand. And it was outside. And I had to take my son, who was 3 weeks, so I was breastfeeding. And I remember he was crying, and Pashat just asked them to bring him to her. He was being passed around in Pashat. And I'm singing, he's so cradling my son Cameron. He'll never forget it all these 3 weeks. He doesn't remember, but he's always telling that story. I'm thinking, I mean, you know. But yeah, and so it's really cute. I've been very lucky. I think it's because of my performance. My performance is really inclusive of people. And people like them, they love that, you know. That's what I do. That's how I got hurt. Over the Ghanaian audience. It'd be good feeling and goodbye. Oh no, that isn't the first one I ever recorded. It was Good Feeling Goodbye was the one I actually promoted. But the one I ever recorded was Song for Ghana. That was Stand Together. Yes. I wrote that for the Black Stars and for equality and unity and whatnot. Yes, Stand Together was the very first one. That was crazy. It's actually a long story. When I had my children, I took quite a long break and then decided to go back into music again. We were signed to a company called Pandemonium, and we brought out a song called Friends, which was quite a hit. It was a cover of Amy Stewart's song, Friends, did really well. And then I brought out a reggae song, again, a cover for Bob Marley's song, Natural Mystic, with a guy called Kayo. And that was in the jazz charts, it was jazz version, for about 8 weeks. And then as time went on, I decided that my daughter got signed to Warner Brothers. She's in a band called Stushy, like I said. So I thought, okay, I was just about to come back again with my record company and do my bit again. And then my daughter got signed. I'm thinking, this is not cool. This is my daughter. I have to like step back and let her shine. Because what would happen is when I come back again and everybody's saying, oh, mom's writing off the daughter's back or the daughter, you know, it was like, oh, that kind. I didn't need it. So I thought, this is my daughter. I want, you know, she's going to succeed, whatever, irrespective of whether I was in it or not. But as a mother, I thought, let me just step back. And I started doing cabaret and theater and, you know, whatnot. So I put all my efforts into theater. And then I met Nanako Fadu through all that. And he asked me to come and sing for him when he was first, you know, running for president. And that was the first time I actually felt inclined to come to Ghana. So he invited me to come and sing, and I did. And I thought, oh my God, I've been gone for so long. I didn't know anybody. And I was listening to the music, and I saw my sister was doing really well. I sort of liked the music, and I'm thinking, ah, they could do with something of mine here, you know? I had nothing else to do. I was sort of working and thinking, and just do what I feel like. You know, that's why I do what I feel like. I'm not really. And then I sort of enjoyed it. And then I set up a business. So it brought me here a lot more. And I did the icons. And then I realized that it would be a good idea to teach some of these girls how to be, you know, how to perform, how to relax, how to learn vocals. Nobody actually was going for vocal lessons or even speech therapy, because you need to. You know, it's to preserve your voice. But sometimes I speak to some of the artists, like, I'm so broke, I can't sing, because they put too much into their vocals. They don't know where they're singing from. And so I thought I'd do that for a while. And then I got invested in it. You know, when you get, your heart gets invested in people, and I love people, you just continue. So I just got stuck and started doing my own music when in between boredom. Yeah, in between boredom. What I want to say about the female artist is I think it's really important that you find out who you are, because all of you, not all of you, some of you are just copying what works with other artists and then doing it. And I see it, you know, and it's not everybody's skill to get off the stage and walk around and sit on people's laps. It isn't. Sometimes you guys do so badly, and you're still doing it because you know it works for other people. So I just think, learn your craft that way. Don't copy other people. It's like, it's just a little ridiculous. Music. Yeah. And fried chicken. London. Catwoman. Because, you see the costume? My favorite was O2 with Stevie Wonder. Don't sleep with anybody for a record deal. Finest experience is with my daughter, and because I've been coaching, and then she got her big record deal with Warner Brothers. That was an amazing moment for me. I think everybody can sing in a different way. I mean, that's why we have rappers and whatnot. You know, because they rap. I think you have to find what it is you're good at doing when you're singing. So it could be just speaking the words, you know, poetry with music is still music, you know, still some kind of singing. But I think some people are saying they should shut up. I've heard some people think, please don't sing. But so I have to answer the question, no, not everybody can sing. I have a song coming out with my sister called, though I've been speaking about it. God, of course, we have to do this freaking video. I mean, we've been talking about it, and then you're going one way and I'm going another. We're going to come together. We have to do it at least before the Christmas period, please. So Odo is beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Hopefully you're going to play it, you know, while I'm talking at some point. That's the latest one coming. I'm going to be recording soon. I want to bring one of my own tracks out very soon. For those who love what I write and what I do. But yes, this the one coming up will be Odo. So look out for it. My extended children, all their grandchildren, and I'm sitting there and I'm telling them stories and teaching them how to strip. Quizzical quiz, kiss me quick. 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 Red leather, yellow leather, red leather, yellow leather, red leather, yellow leather. I study my, you know, my vocal exercises, tongue twisters. Okay. Wow, you see the costume?